And now it's time for the Eagle's Nest. Join us for the next half hour for the ministry of the Eagle's Nest Christian Fellowship in Southern California. Experience the exciting musical guest and enjoy the unique ministry of Pastor Gary Greeenwald as he shares Eagle's food from the Eagle's Nest.
I've stood and watched the eagle in flight. Watched her soar so gracefully and thought I'd like to be as you are. Running free, running free.
And now, here's Pastor Gary.
I've stood on the mountain and felt the cool wind.
Hello, I'm Pastor Gary, and I'm doing a message called Halloween, a diabolical trick or a harmless treat. I'm going to finish my message tonight, and we're going to talk about some of the curses that are invited upon us when we indulge ourselves in the celebration of Halloween. You see, the Bible says that a curse will not come without a cause. We have to invite the curse. And I want you to remember that Satan only has power over those who follow after his pernicious ways, those who open evil doors to bring on curses and destruction. As long as you do not involve yourselves in the things of Satan, you're safe. But when you send your children out trick-or-treating, when you let them go to parties where Satan is glorified, when you let them dress up as ghouls and goblins and all kinds of satanic creatures and skeletons and Satan witches, when you do these things, you're opening the door for their oppression. And I want to tell you tonight about curses. You see, I read a book recently called The Curse of the Pharaohs by Philip Vandenberg, and in it told about the supernatural events that followed the opening and the violation of King Tut's tomb. It really got me to thinking about how we open ourselves up to occultic things when we involve ourselves in Halloween. There seems to be something hanging around me right now. Oh, hello. I didn't know this was coming on the set, but bless God, we're out here in the cemetery. I guess you can expect this kind of thing to be thrown up. Anyway, in reading this book by Philip Vandenberg, thank you, sir, it was on the curse of the pharaohs. And I'd like to give you just a little follow-up of what happens when you open a curse of Satan. You see, there was a tablet inscription in Tutankhamun's tomb that said this. When they opened the tomb, there was this tablet inscription that said this: "Death will slay with his wings whoever disturbs the peace of the Pharaoh." Now, many of you don't believe in curses. You don't realize that there are curses that we invite upon ourselves. Many of you don't believe in it, just like Dr. Gamal Mirez. He said, "I don't believe in the curse of the Pharaohs." He was the director of the Egyptian Museum in Cairo in an interview with Philip Vandenberg. But 4 weeks later, on the same day that Tutankhamun's golden mask was being readied for a trip to London, Mirez died at age 52 from a circulatory collapse. You see, you don't play with curses. His was only the latest in a series of more than 30 untimely deaths of researchers and archaeologists who have excavated in Egypt since 1900. Why did they die? Did the ancient Egyptians deliberately turn their pharaohs' rock-bound tombs into death traps for the unwary? 4,000 years later, are we opening up death traps now as we go into these tombs? Tutankhamun is the key figure in the curse. He's King Tut. And this curse, to date, has cost the lives of at least 36 scientists, archaeologists, and scholars. His real importance stems from the relatively late discovery of his tomb, which, unlike those of other pharaohs, has not been plundered, and from the fact that a series of mysterious deaths have followed the grave's excavation. The curse of the pharaohs then began to excite scientists for the first time. You see, scientists are looking into these curses now. They realize that something supernatural has happened now that King Tut's tomb has been violated, just as many other of the tombs in the past have been violated and curses have been unleashed. Many people have died in the past. Let me read you a description of the moment the tomb was violated. Howard Carter says it this way: "Slowly, desperately, slowly, it seemed to us, as we watched, the remains of the passage debris that encumbered the lower part of the doorway were removed, until at last We had the whole door cleared before us. The decisive moment had arrived. With trembling hands, I made a tiny breach in the upper left-hand corner. Darkness and blank space as far as an iron testing rod could reach showed that whatever lay beyond was empty and not filled like the passage we had just cleared. Candle tests were applied as a precaution against possible foul gases, and then, widening the hole a little, I inserted the candle and peered in. Lord Carnarvon, Lady Evelyn, and Callender, one of his assistants, standing anxiously beside me to hear the verdict. At first, I could see nothing, the hot air escaping from the chamber causing the candle flame to flicker. But presently, as my eyes grew accustomed to the light, details of the room within emerged slowly from the mist. Strange animals, statues, and gold everywhere, the glint of gold. For the moment and eternity it must have seemed to the others standing by, I was struck dumb with amazement. There was a beautiful lotiform cup of translucent alabaster, a confused pile of overturned chariots glistening with gold and inlay, two life-size figures of a king in black facing each other like sentinels, gold-kilted, gold-sandaled, armed with mace and staff, the protective sacred cobra upon their foreheads. Also, there were three great gilded couches, strange black shrines, and a golden inlaid throne. Now, many of you have seen the mask that was taken from the tomb of King Tut. This mask I'm putting up right now, this golden mask, has become so popular and famous, we've had many symbols of it that have been worn as jewelry. And let me warn you today that Egyptian jewelry can invite curses also, but I'm not doing that message today. You see, opening the tomb seemed like such a harmless act, but those at the site, especially the scholars, were very concerned. In fact, they became increasingly nervous. The reason for their concern was an ordinary clay tablet that Carter had found in the antechamber. He had it cataloged, as he did the other objects. Then a few days later, Alan Gardiner decoded the hieroglyphics on it. The inscription read, "Death will slay with his wings whoever disturbs the peace of the Pharaoh." There was a curse upon those that opened the tomb. Significantly, the curse was found a second time in a somewhat changed form on the back of a statue. On the statue it said, "It is I who drive back the robbers of the tomb with the flames of the desert. I am the protector of Tutankhamun's grave." This magic figure was discovered in the main chamber of the tomb. You know, the earliest Egyptians were a religious people who believed in miracles and ghosts and spirits. I believe as Christians who believe in the Bible, we also should believe in miracles, the supernatural, and evil spirits and even curses. None of the 20-man staff that had gathered at 2 p.m. on that hot February day in the passageway of the tomb knew if they would find a pharaoh's mummy in it, and surely no one suspected that 13 of them would shortly die. Isn't it ironic that 13 of the people that entered that tomb died shortly afterward? Out of 20, 13 died. Here's a slide of the mummy with that mask we showed earlier. This shows the mummy that they found as they went into the tomb. And just as the archaeologists ignored the curses of those tombs, I want to ask you, can we ignore God's curses to those who identify with Satan at Halloween? Did you know that God puts a curse on those who indulge in Halloween practices or send their kids out on the streets? You know, God's curses are even worse than those of the heathen. Deuteronomy 7, verse 26, speaking of images of heathen gods and evil occultic figures, says this. God speaks. He says, "Neither shalt thou bring an abominable thing into thine house, lest thou be a cursed thing like it. But thou shalt utterly detest it, thou shalt utterly abhor it, for it is a cursed thing." God says, don't bring that abominable thing, that mask, that hideous costume, that pumpkin, that thing of the occult into the house. Don't bring witches and goblins and all that occultic paraphernalia into the house, lest you be accursed as it is. Now, Christians, I'm talking to you from the heart today. Do you really want to invite God's curses on you by involving yourself in Halloween? Don't you realize how real this is? This next slide as I put it up, I want to ask, do we dare bring these demonic Halloween masks and pumpkins into our houses? Do you see these masks? Do they look godly? Is there no difference between us and the unbelievers? The Bible says that God has put a difference between us and the heathen. And if we identify with the heathen and do what they do, that means we're saying, God, we don't believe there is a difference. Well, I want to finish this message today and talk a little more about Proverbs 26, verse 2. It says, the curse causeless shall not come. You see, we invite and bring on the curses. We invite them. They come only because we open the doors to Satan to hurt us and harm us. Jayne Mansfield, you all remember that blonde bombshell named Jayne Mansfield? She was the voluptuous starlet who came to the movies as a sex star years ago, and she joined the Church of Satan. There was a man by the name of Anton LaVey. Let me put a picture of Anton LaVey in one of his ceremonies with a young girl up on the screen for you. Anton LaVey was the Satanic High Priest of the Church of Satan, and she worshipped under this man. Then, one time, during her involvement with the Satanic Church, Jayne Mansfield started going out with a boyfriend named Sam Brody. Now, Anton LaVey didn't like Brody, and he told Mansfield not to see him. When Mansfield continued to see Brody, LaVey publicly put a curse on Brody. Now, the curse stated that within a year, some tragedy would befall Sam Brody. If you will remember, in that year, Jayne Mansfield and Sam Brody were both killed in a violent automobile accident, and Jane's head was literally decapitated from her body. LaVey, in the newspapers, publicly took credit for Brody's death. He said, the curse that I predicted in the name of Satan came to pass. Now, when we dabble with the occult, I believe that we're inviting death. I believe many children today, without knowing it, they're so innocent, but they're having curses invited upon them by involving themselves in Halloween. Remember the testimony a couple of weeks ago I shared where a young boy had gone to a Halloween haunt, and in the house, when he walked in, a head was rolling down the stairs, just a fake head with blood coming out or something that looked like blood. And it sent such a trauma into that little boy that 10 years later, he had no hair, no eyebrows. He was like a vegetable. They said he was like a zombie. He was no good in school. That night, when he had come home, he would not come out of the hysteria. His mother said that all of his hair fell out. By the next day, when they were bathing him, all of his hair fell out. Do we dare do that to our children? You know, with all the kooks and weirdos and demented maniacs in the world, I wouldn't want to send my kids out on the streets door to door. There are a lot of weirdos out. I think nobody could deny there's a lot of weirdos out. They're all over here, too. You should see all the technicians working with me tonight. But when you hear the stories of contaminated food and razor blades in apples, have you heard of the kids that pick up the contaminated food and they bring home apples with razor blades in them? And LSD and drugs that are in the candies and cookies. When you see this, you know, you can't deny that Halloween is a satanic night. If you look at this next slide, I don't believe that. If you look at my next slide, the witches and the Satan worshippers are celebrating everywhere on Halloween night, and there are many human sacrifices. Seriously, though, let's talk seriously for a moment. There are many human sacrifices on Halloween night, and when we involve ourselves, we may get involved in that kind of activity. Worst of all, evil spirits are roaming about in mass to celebrate this night. Have you ever noticed how many children get violently ill around Halloween, and you always thought it was the candy? Let me show you another slide. Do you want to help celebrate the night of death by sending your kids out? Do we dare celebrate this night of death? I believe that carved out pumpkins and repulsive costumes and pictures of witches and ghosts and all the objects relating to Satan's world are abominable, cursed objects and unclean. And God says, keep them out of your house. Let me read it again. Deuteronomy 7:26. Neither shalt thou bring an abomination into thine house, lest thou be a cursed thing like it, but thou shalt utterly detest it, and thou shalt utterly abhor it, for it is a cursed thing. Now, let me just finish today's message with some of the arguments that I hear parents come across with. They say, but isn't it such a cute mask of Frankenstein? It's such a cute little mask. Let me show you a picture of the Frankenstein that years ago I used to watch in the movies. The novel Frankenstein was written by Mary Shelley, and some of you would say it's just a harmless horror story about a creature that had his hands and legs sewn on and a heart from a grave put in his body. But was that authoress sweet and harmless? Mary Shelley was a cocaine addict and wrote this fiendish novel while sitting on her mother's grave. Very interesting for a harmless little lady. Speaking of the devil. Hi, Frank. How are you tonight? Don't have much to say? Tongue-tied? Somebody's got to put a tongue in his body, I think. Mary Shelley, as I said, wrote this novel while sitting on her mother's grave. Isn't it nice to know you were talked about on your mother's grave? When her husband died by drowning, she went down to the beach and cut his heart out. She burned the rest of his body and kept his heart in a box. Nice lady to write the novel, isn't it? And we send our kids out dressed up in harmless Frankenstein monster suits. You know, I used to watch the movies about Frankenstein. Let me show you this picture of Frankenstein's laboratory where he built the monster. I remember this exact movie the night that I watched it. I was so terrified. My parents were out. I was all alone at home. I was watching this movie, and I was terrorized, and I saw them lift that monster up into the area where the lightning could get to it, and I watched, and fear began to grip me, and I remember that night when it was over, I went to my bed, and I was afraid that hands were going to come up from underneath my bed. Such a spirit of fear. I needed a nightlight for a long time. I still suck my thumb in the middle of the night sometimes from fear. Just kidding. Just kidding. But Frankenstein really had its effect on me. Then how about those cute vampire costumes? With the teeth and the fangs and the blood dripping. Well, vampirism denotes a person who has a blood or fetish, a flesh fetish. Someone who loves blood or loves to eat flesh. Now, a lot of you, if you look at this picture of Bela Lugosi, who was one of the most popular vampires, or let's call him the Dracula figure, a lot of us that remember that think that Dracula was a real person, and actually he was. Castle Dracula is in Romania. It was inhabited by a personage called Valid the Impaler in the Middle Ages, who was a bloodthirsty person. And Count Dracula was written by Bram Stoker, and Hollywood made the Bela Lugosi-type character very popular. Now, yes, you may say it's absolutely harmless to have your children imitate bloodthirsty creatures who suck blood for pleasure, but I want you to remember, you can't take the sting out of a scorpion by calling it a marshmallow. You can't say that it's fun to suck blood when God says it's an abomination in his sight. Let me show you another slide of children who identify with the hideous creatures. This is the kind of creature that they identify with. This is from Tales from the Crypt. 2 Corinthians 6, verses 17 and 18 says, "Come out from amongst them and be ye separate, saith the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you, and will be a father unto you, and you shall be my sons and daughters, saith the Lord Almighty." But he says you must come out from amongst this activity. In Joshua 24, verse 15, Joshua shouted, "Choose you this day whom you will serve." Now, you've got to choose whether you're going to serve the true God or the gods of the heathen nations. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord, Joshua said. And I want to ask today, whose side are you on? Now, a lot of you are still complaining that it's not right to take away Halloween from the little kids. And let me put up one more slide as I ask you this question. Do you want them to become Satan's prey? Do you think it's too cruel to take Halloween away? Well, don't take it away. Just let them celebrate by dressing up as little Christian characters or saints of the Bible. Let them dress up. Give them candy. You can buy a little candy for them, but take them to a movie or take them somewhere where they can enjoy bowling or some other activity. Don't let them get involved in activities. I'd encourage other churches to have a party for the kids. Churches need to know that it's their responsibility. The pastors of churches will answer to God if they allow their churches to celebrate this holiday. So right now, accept Jesus into your heart. renounce Satan and his activities and become a God-centered human being, a Christian. Amen.
The Eagle's Nest would like to make today's message available to you on cassette tape. The complete Halloween message comes to you on 2 one-hour cassettes. To receive both of these cassettes, along with a complete catalog of other messages by Pastor Gary, please send any donation of $10 or more to The Eagle's Nest, Irvine, California, 92714. That's The Eagle's Nest, Irvine, California, 92714. As a special bonus, we will send with your cassettes a book written by Pastor Gary about the punk rock craze sweeping our nation. The title of this book is The Punk Called Rock. Again, to receive both the Halloween cassettes and the punk rock book, simply request the Halloween offer and send your donations of $10 or more to The Eagle's Nest, Irvine, California, 92714. Thank you and God bless you.
I want to remind you again that it's your giving and your love gifts and donations that have kept this ministry going. If you appreciate what we're saying and how we've exposed Satan's rock music and the punk rock craze and Halloween and some of these tricks of the devil, please get behind this ministry. If you do buy our two cassettes and the punk rock book, why don't you send in $10 or more to help support this ministry, because we want to stay on television and continue to spread the word. I just appreciate all of you. And I'd like to close tonight's message by telling you just a little bit about what our church is doing for Halloween. A lot of the pastors will see this and they'll say, well, what can I do? What can the kids do as an alternative? Let me talk to parents and pastors for a moment. If you're a parent, I might suggest that you take the kids out to an ice cream parlor or to an ice skating rink or a bowling alley or a nice family film or anything to get them away from the house where they'll see all the trick-or-treaters, and give them a bag full of candy. Go out and buy them some sugarless candy or something that they can take to school the next day and say, we were celebrating Halloween too. But they need a Christian alternative. Especially pastors need to do, I believe, what we're doing. This year, we're showing a Walt Disney film at our church. We're going to bring it into the church and advertise and have all the kids come out. And we're allowing them to come out, telling them that there's going to be candy for all the children. We're buying a lot of sugarless candy and good, healthy fruits and apples and things that we can give them. We're also going to have them all dress up like Bible characters, and all of our kids get really excited at Halloween time because they can dress up like their favorite Bible character, and they can be in a contest that we have. And we do pick out the best Bible characters. We give them another prize. And it's a great night with all the refreshments and the excitement that we have. And I invite every church pastor to give an alternative to the kids for Halloween. Now, parents, let me say this. If you want to still let your children go out on the streets at Halloween time because you think it'd be cruel not to let them, let me show you what Mark 9:42 says to you. It says, and whosoever shall offend, and that word means to stumble, one of these little ones that believe in me, it is better for him that a millstone were hanged about his neck and he were cast into the sea. God says if you are going to stumble these children by letting them identify with Satan and ghoulish costumes and horrendous things, then you are going to answer to God. It'd be better that a millstone were around your neck than that you should stumble those little ones. Now, I've been talking about how Halloween should not be in the church. It should be taken out of the church. If I might recap a little of what we've been speaking about, I said that years ago I was involved with a Christian organization that celebrated Halloween, but they did it more for money. They charged for the kids that came through the house, and they just scared the little children to the place of hysterics. Little girls wet their pants, boys screamed, and some of the kids were traumatized, and I just began to see that the Bible says, give no place to the evil, give no place to the devil. And the Bible also warns us that we should not take place in the spirit of fear. God has not given us the spirit of fear, 2 Timothy 1:7, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. And the Bible also tells us that we should take no place, abstain from all appearance of evil. And I don't believe you can take place in Halloween and be abstaining from all appearance of evil. And as we scared those young kids and the teenagers in those days, and I admit that I was involved with that haunted house. I wasn't spirit-filled. I really didn't know what I know now. I must say that I feel bad, and I ask God to forgive me, because a lot of those children may have left God as a result of that haunted house. Because they might have thought, if this is what Christianity is, if our church puts on a haunted house and dresses up like the devil, what difference is there between us and the devil? And the Bible says that God has put a difference between us and the heathen. In Exodus 11:7, he says that no dog would move his tongue. Oh, getting a little more lightning here. It said that no dog would bark or move his tongue against the children of Israel when they were about to come out of Egypt, because God said that ye may know that the Lord doth put a difference between the Egyptians and Israel. God says there's a difference between us and the world. The Bible says, come out from amongst the world. Don't take part in its occultic traditions. And we've proven that Satan's holiday, Halloween or Samhain, is an occultic. It's an occultic holiday, an occultic celebration. There's nothing Christian about it, even though the Catholic Church at one time tried to call it All Saints Day, and the people would dress up as Bible characters, but there is nothing Christian about Halloween. We should not partake in it in any way. The horror movies that are out today are just preparing the kids for violence and fear. Movies like Amityville 2, The Possession, like The Exorcist. We see movies like Halloween Part 3, which shows people mutilated and cut into pieces, and people with axes through their heads, and movies like The Thing, which depicts people exploding and body parts being mutated and heads crawling around with spider-like tentacles. This kind of thing is programming our young people for violence. It's programming them with fear that drives them to torment. And it's also causing our young people to be desensitized to both violence and sex, and to be conditioned to look into the supernatural and the occult. Again, let me warn you, parents, it's time to come out from amongst them and be ye separate. Let's pray now. Father, in the name of Jesus, we just apologize. We're so sorry that we've involved ourselves in Halloween, and we declare tonight that we're going to follow you, that we're going to let Jesus be the Lord of our lives, and we renounce Satan and all of his activities and all involvement in the occult. Right now, we make Jesus Lord, and we praise you that we're free. Glory to God. Amen.
Have you ever wished that you could fly like an eagle through the sky and rise above the things in life that make you sad?
Thank you for joining us at the Eagle's Nest with Pastor Gary Greeenwald. If you'd like a copy of today's message or a tape catalog of other messages by Pastor Gary, please write to the Eagle's Nest, Irvine, California, 92714. That's the Eagle's Nest, Irvine, California, 92714. Join us next time for more Eagles food with Pastor Gary from the Eagle's Nest.